Jesus is speaking to his disciples. He's speaking about taking up the cross. Metaphorically, that means trying each day to live the life he's inviting them to live. And that is for us as well. So hear these words. For what will it profit if they gain the whole world, but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Some of you have been introduced to Adam Hamilton this morning through your Sunday school series. We're going to be studying Adam's book for the next 3 weeks, and entitled Enough. And one of the things that Adam suggests in the book is that we are confronted by a three-headed monster. Now, not the kind of monster that you might look under your bed at night to make sure is not there anymore, because there's not one. Okay? I want to be sure that boys and girls don't leave here thinking that the preacher said there's a monster under their bed. There's no monsters under your bed. However, we adults are confronted every day of our life by a three-headed monster in our society today. Its name is envy, greed, and gluttony. A three-headed monster, a formidable three-headed monster, if you look deep enough into our culture. Envy is that monster that infuses us. It gets inside us. It seeps in. In fact, Adam Hamilton says, you don't have to rob a bank to be an immoral person. You don't have to break your marriage vows to be an immoral person. You can allow this monster, this three-headed monster, to infiltrate your life and slowly but surely try to take over your will and your mind. With envy, it's, I see something I want. I see something, and then I begin to think, how can I get it? What do I have to give up to get it? What is it going to take for me to get that? I walked past one of the men's stores here in town the other day, and I saw this blazer. Y'all know me if you've been here. Y'all know what my temptations are. And I said, how much does that blazer cost? And when they told me how much it cost, I thought, if I bought that blazer, it doesn't matter how much time they would give me to pay for it, it would be immoral. If my mama found out I even wanted a blazer that cost that much, she would have a duck. That's not to mention curry. I know about envy. In fact, driving to worship this morning at 8:30 with my son, Case, and it was kind of quiet, and I started thinking about this message, and I started thinking about, I'm going to impress everybody at the church and tell them that out of the four vehicles that I have, almost all of them are paid for. I got three payments on Curry's van. Everything else is paid for, paid cash for some of it. I was going to impress y'all and tell you how many miles collectively I had on all four of my vehicles. Over 400,000 miles. You should be impressed. But when I look around the parking lot here, I envy some of y'all that y'all are driving some cars. There's some nice cars and SUVs in this, and pickup trucks. Lord have mercy, they are expensive. I know what that monster's like inside of me. And that's just envy. Greed says, I want it, and I'm going to do whatever it takes to get it. And when I get it, I ain't sharing it with nobody. Go get your own. And then there's gluttony, that third head of that monster. I want it. In fact, it reminds me of that Tim McGraw song. What is it? I like it. I want it. I want some more of it. And once I get it, I can't get enough. I used to make fun. In fact, before I met Curry, or before I married Curry, her brothers asked me, did I know how many pairs of shoes she had? And I'm not picking on her this morning because I'm fixing to turn this on me. They said we used to call her Imelda Marcos. Those of you who are old enough know who I'm talking about. But fellas, I'm embarrassed to tell you I have almost as many shoes as she does. And today I can't wear my white Bucks anymore because it's the last Sunday before Labor Day. Yeah, again, I told y'all, I have my own idiosyncrasies. And I have to put my white Bucks up too. Gluttony. And I see stuff on the internet that they're selling for cheap. And I'm thinking, I can't do that. Do you know that monster? I don't care how frugal you are. You have wants that are extending of your needs. In fact, it's so prevalent in our culture. Mark Huffington, who you know is a former senator and the Huffington Post, he talks about our culture today. He says that we're more interested in money and success and notoriety and fame and glory than we are spirituality and peace of mind and contentment. And it's hard to have peace of mind and contentment when you've got your financial picture turned upside down. You can get mortgages today up for 50 years. Y'all think about that. Especially if it's your adult child. Huffington had a great career and was a senator in California for years, and he was a fine businessman, and he had a modicum of fame in himself, he said, but when he lost his last election, everything came crashing down, and he saw his life as a tragedy. He wouldn't be in the news anymore. He wouldn't be famous. He wouldn't have the same lifestyle he was accustomed to. He said, but out of that, one of the best things that ever happened to him happened. He came to know not MasterCard, but the master of the universe. He developed a relationship of Christian faith, and in fact, he joined the Eastern Orthodox Church, and he spent time in a monastery. He said it was one of the smartest, best decisions he ever made in his life. And he began to live much more simply, with not so much trappings, not so much stuff. And he said he attended a church that on the back wall of the church was the scripture that I read just a moment ago. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his soul? Now, I've been wrestling this week with that question. My wife and I have talked about our financial picture, that we need to make some adjustments, and we are going to do that over the next couple of weeks. I want you to know that if you really want to find out what you value, if you really want to find out where your priorities are, for some of you, I'll say, look in your checkbook. Others of you who use debit cards, look at that report that comes back at the end of the month and see where all your money goes, because that's a clear indication of what you value. See in that conversation with yourself and your checkbook or your statement from your card where God fits in. Where God fits in. How is it with your soul? Do you have real peace? The peace that passes all understanding? I wrestle with that stuff. just like you do. I told you, I like nice stuff. I would give anything if I could have my dad's 1958 Corvette 2-speed Power Glide, blue and white. Give anything. Not yet. Some of you have lived long enough and you've managed yourselves well and you're in retirement. And yes, some of that's fixed. But some of us in this room are still learning. And we're still growing. And we're still learning about where God fits into those checkbooks and those reports at the end of the month with our debit card. John Wesley said this a long time ago. He said, earn all you can. Save all you can. And give all you can. Key word in all three of those statements is all. I had a young couple in my church in Meridian. We were going through a capital campaign to remodel our sanctuary. The sanctuary had not been remodeled in 50 years. It was going to take about $1 million. Congregation was smaller than this. But we had a young couple in our church, and they were young professionals. Stephen was an accountant, and Christy was a nurse, and they had a little girl named Grace who was in elementary school. And I'll never forget that we started asking for people to start telling their stories about their faith experience and how they were committed to giving money and sacrificial gifts to this church so that we could, y'all know this, y'all done this, but I want you to hear their story. They were about to build their dream home. They'd been married about 10 years and they'd been saving money, and Stephen was, he was a penny pincher and he was a bean counter. And he went to the mortgage, he talked to his contractor, and they'd gotten a price, and they had a couple of different prices and bids on building their house. And he went to the bank, to the mortgage lender, and they talked. And in the discovery and conversation, Stephen found out that the mortgage he was offered would cost him more money each month than he was given to God. This guy's 32 years old. And he said to his banker, then I'm going to go back to my contractor and build a smaller house. He said, I'm not willing to give more money to the bank than I am to the Lord. Stephen's soul was in a good place. How about you? How is it with your soul today? I invite you to join Curry and Graham and Kaysen and I to confront the monster. We have a God who can give us wisdom and discernment so that we can live more simply and freely and find the joy of giving. In the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. Amen. There are many of you who are worshiping with us, with Sharon and her girls and their families today, who may not be familiar with the United Methodist Church tradition. This is the Lord's table. This is not the Methodist table.